So we discussed this concept of fecal coliforms in a previous video. I will put that in the upper right-hand corner. It's a really good background. In today's video, I want to discuss one of the most common types of fecal coliforms, organisms that cause intestinal disease that often lead to vomiting, diarrhea, dehydration, and in some cases, even death. So the one that we're going to be talking about today is E. coli. E. coli is a gram-negative rod. It is a facultative anaerobe. It is a chemo-organotroph, things that we have discussed in previous videos. E. coli is an interesting organism because not only can it be a pathogen, but it's also part of our normal flora, our normal microbiota, and you can often find E. coli lining the digestive systems of human beings and other animals. Now, often, in terms of its transmission, it is a fecal-oral organism, as coliforms are, and it's usually going to be contracted through contaminated water or through contaminated food, in particular undercooked beef, and especially leafy greens, vegetables that are not washed properly, fruits that are not washed properly. And in fact, when we used to run fecal coliform tests at one of the labs I was at previously, we would find that there were more fecal coliforms in a lot of the unwashed vegetables, even relative to unwashed chicken and ground beef, raw ground beef. Preparing your vegetables when you're making salads, when you are eating fruit, especially fruit where you're not removing the skin, make sure that that stuff is washed thoroughly. There are higher risk groups, and that usually revolves around people who have an immune system that is weakened in some way. So really young children whose immune systems aren't fully developed, the elderly, where the immune system can sometimes be compromised. And then, of course, immunocompromised people who maybe have HIV or they are undergoing some type of chemotherapy or treatment that is weakening the immune system. Now, in terms of the pathology of E. coli, there are different types of E. coli, different substrains. You've got the enterotoxigenic, and that is going to release some enterotoxins that can make us sick, and usually there's going to be watery diarrhea and abdominal cramps and nausea as part of that. The enteropathogenic, usually found in infants in developing countries. Often it's going to be prolonged watery diarrhea. The one that is often the scariest, or even sometimes that makes the news, is the enterohemorrhagic E. coli, and that is especially true of 0157H7. And so that can cause bloody diarrhea, that can cause hemolytic uremic syndrome. There is a shigatoxin that is involved there that is going to damage endothelial tissue in the intestines. And of course, the complications, if it's left untreated, can go into kidney failure. And that can be especially true in children. An E. coli infection can last anywhere from around 5 to 7 days. It depends on the individual, the strain of E. coli that's causing the infection. And again, it's really about supportive care during that time. And there are other types of intestinal E. coli infections as well. And E. coli can infect other parts of the body and can also be involved in UTI infections. So when it comes to diagnosis, there are stool cultures that can be done. There are urinalysis for the UTIs. PCR, serotyping can all be done to determine what type of E. coli is causing an infection. The prevention side, again, I mentioned it briefly, but washing hands, definitely after going to the bathroom, washing hands before cooking and preparing food. Make sure that the food that you make, if it's raw vegetables, if it's fruits, they're washed. Make sure your meats are thoroughly cooked. Mostly your ground beef, that is going to be usually the highest concern when it comes to meats. And be a little bit careful. I know the rage right now is all the unpasteurized milk and juices, and I understand why that is, but there is an increased risk of contracting bacterial infection when drinking unpasteurized dairy products. And so just understand that that risk is there. And if you're going to be traveling to an undeveloped area or an underdeveloped area, it might be best to just stick with bottled water and not use the tap water for cooking, and certainly not for drinking. On the public health side, surveillance is something that is certainly done, because once an outbreak happens, it can be a little bit problematic. And so the sooner you can catch those outbreaks, the easier it is to deal with that. Inspecting food processing facilities is really important, and restaurants as well. Making sure that water sanitation programs are in place and that the water treatment facilities are doing what they're supposed to do. Treatment is a little interesting here with E. coli. It's mostly supportive care, because one of the main things that we talked about when it came to the pathology is the amount of dehydration that can occur. And so making sure that a patient has fluids and is staying rehydrated, to account for the water that is lost through diarrhea or vomiting, especially important. What's interesting here is antibiotics are not often recommended because the antibiotics can do damage to normal flora. And if that happens, that allows more space for the pathogenic E. coli to colonize and can actually make the problem worse at times. And so you have to be a little bit careful with the antibiotic usage when it comes to E. coli infection. All right, everyone. So that is a brief overview of E. coli infection. As always, thank you so much for being here. Hope you have a great week.